So we have been discussing on loop slot and patch antenna and horn antenna. So first we'll discuss on loop antenna. So the loop antenna is a radiating coil of any cross section. So we can see that and one or more turns carrying radio frequency current. So we have different loops here, which is of the shape of triangle, square, and circular shape. So have you made a note of it? You can just write down first one, loop antenna. So its loop antenna is a radiating coil of any cross section of one or more turns carrying the frequency current, radio frequency current. And it is having three different shapes, you can say. It can be in the shape of triangular, square, and circular shape. You have the closed feed by a transmission line or coaxial cable. Okay, so this is of that shape. You can see that you have triangular, square, and circular shape. So you can make a note of these things. So you can draw this figure. You can see that the antenna, loop antenna, can be of the shape of triangular shape, square, and circular shape, and this is what you get it. So the radiating coil or any cross section of one or more returns carrying ratio of frequency, radio frequency current, and we have the coaxial cable which acts as the transmission line, and you can say that you have the three shapes, different shapes it can be. Triangular, circular, and square. So you can make a note of these things. So further discussing upon that, you have completed these things now in the previous class itself.
No, sir.
Okay. Okay, completed. Write down module 5, loop horn and loop antenna, horn antenna. So we are going to discuss upon loop antenna here. So these points you can make a note of that. So the dimension of a loop antenna, you receive all these antennas are required for the specific design, and the dimension of loop antenna is specified by the area occupied by the loop. We have to find out the area occupied by the loop, all those things. So we will discuss upon these things. You can keep a note of all these points. So we have seen the three types, triangular, square, and circular shape. So these things can be utilized for the loop antennas. So the dimension of the loop antenna is specified by the area occupied by the loop. And when the area A is very small as compared to the lambda square, so we can say that it is said to be a small loop. So we have seen all those things before. So we have seen in the previous module, we have seen that field due to thin linear antenna, and what do you mean by a short dipole, what do you mean by a thin linear antenna, and all those things. We have also calculated the radiation resistance of a thin linear antenna. In the previous classes, we have discussed upon the far field, all those components as well. So continuing with that, you can say that the dimension of the loop antenna can be specified by the area occupied by the loop. So how much the area is occupied by the loop is very important, and when the area A is very small compared to lambda square, it is said to be a small loop, that is A less than lambda square by 100. So you are going to get A less than lambda square by 100, and for this dimension of a loop antenna is specified by its area. And you know that it is of three different types, as we have seen: triangular, circular, and square. And all these things are very much required also to find out that how you call it as a small loop. So the condition to be specified as a small loop is A should be less than lambda square by 100. Okay. So those things we have to be very much clear with it. In the previous classes, we have discussed about the short antenna and all those things, where we have discussed about the length of the antenna and the diameter of the antenna. Similarly, when you talk about here, that is the small loops, so you can say that you can call it as a small loop when the area of that is less than lambda square by 100. So that's what a small loop is. Four directional, you can say that it will be in all the four directions, and all these parameters you can find out, and also you can discuss upon the radiation pattern and directivity, gain, and all those things of various types of loops. And when you understand those things, a small square loop is always in four direction, and the small circular loop is called as an omnidirectional one. In the plane conducting the loop, and assuming that the current is uniform in phase, so you have to also see that the current is uniform in phase and throughout the length. Okay, so that is what you can see here. A small square loop is four directional, and the small circular loop is omnidirection in the plane containing the loops, assuming the current in uniform and in phase throughout the length. So that is what you can talk about the small loops, where A is less than lambda square by 100, and where you can say that we can have the loops to be in the form of small loops, and also the small square loops is four directional, and small circular loops will be in the omnidirectional to the plane conducting the loops, and assuming that the current is uniform and in phase throughout the length. So that is what you can find out here. And now we have to study in detail about small loops, and how the equations can be derived for that. So here the condition for small loop is A, area of the loop should be less than lambda square by 100. And that's what we have. And a small square loop will be in the four direction, and a small circular loop, it will be in the omnidirection in the plane containing the loops. And you have to assume that the current is uniform in phase and throughout the length. So this is what you have. You can make a note of these things. Then we will discuss upon the small loops. So you can make a note of these things. So we will be understanding small loops. To understand small loops, what we have to understand here is the condition of area less than lambda square by 100. So you can see that everything we classified with respect to it can be short dipole or it can be thin linear antenna or whatever it is, we have been discussing with respect to lambda. You might have observed it. So here also the area of the loop is compared with lambda square by 100, and it should be less than lambda square by 100 to call it as a small loop. So you can just write down this small loops as the topic. Small loops means the field pattern of a small circular loop of radius is A is determined by considering the square of the same. So we will consider this loop and we will take its area and all those things. So we will be discussing all these things in detail with respect to small loops, and we have to discuss upon few equations, that is d square is equal to pi a square, and we will be considering the far field. So we will carry on. Loop antenna can be called as a small loop when A is less than lambda square by 100. So this condition is very important for us, A less than lambda square by 100. So a small square loop is four directional, so that also we can say that, and a small circular loop is omnidirectional. So these things were discussed in the previous lecture. And now we are going to discuss upon further on small loop. So condition for small loop, as I have told you, that is A less than lambda square by 100. So this is the condition for the small loop. So when we move ahead further, the small loops, we can say that the field pattern of a small circular loop of radius A is determined by considering the square loop of the same area. So we are going to now focus upon the small loop, where we define the small loop as if you take the area of the loop, you can say that it should be less than lambda square by 100. So if the condition satisfies that A less than lambda square by 100, then we can say that we can classify that as a small loop. So that is what we understand here. Then we will discuss all from here on, we will discuss for this today's class. Okay. So now I am considering a small loop, and now we know that we have a circular, small circular loop of radius A. So you can see in figure, this is the diameter 2A. So you know that the radius is A. And we have considered a small circular loop of radius A is determined by considering a square loop of the same area. So you can see that a circular loop is considered, and we can also take we can determine this by considering a square loop. So we are just rearranging this circular loop as a square section. Okay. So when you do that, you know that d square is equal to pi a square. So we get d square will be equal to pi a square, and the field pattern you can find out of all these things. So what we have considered here, the considered a circular loop of radius A, and we to determine this we have considered the same area in the form of a square, and one of the length is d. Okay. So that's what you can see. Okay. Yeah. So we will just continue with that, where we can see that we are going to discuss upon a small loop, and where you can see that the field pattern of a small circular loop of radius A is determined. So what you can see in the figure clearly, that we have considered a circular loop of radius a, and we are just converting that in the form of a square. So the same area, the area remains the same here when you convert it into a square loop as well. So the one of the length of this will be d. Okay, so you know that it is converted as a square. So in the previous class we have already discussed upon what do you mean by a small what do you mean by a small loop and all those things, and we also have discussed upon the condition of being considered as a small loop. So that is what we know, that small loop is a less than lambda square by 100. So now here we have discussed upon the small loop, and now I have considered a circle of radius a and converted. So when you go with that d square, when you take d square, you can interrelate these things. So d square can be written as pi a square. So these are all basic equations what you have studied in your previous semesters or in your previous classes. So you can just note down these points. You can draw this. So you can draw that and continue with the thing. So we will you can just complete it. You can write down the points, small loop. So that condition also you can write there, for considering small loop, a should be less than lambda square by 100. So this figure you can complete it. We have to derive the entire process, so we will be doing with that. So we have clearly understood that we are going to now consider for a square loop, and we are going to see the entire process for the square loop. So it is assumed that the loop dimensions are small compared to the wavelength. So this we know that the we can assume that the loop dimensions are small compared to that of the wavelength in the small loop. And the far field pattern, you know that we are discussing everything in the far field pattern. So you have in the previous modules you have studied what do you mean by near field, far field, and how you classify far field, and what are the other, we can say it as Fresnel and Fraunhofer zones also. So that all those things which we have discussed, we can understand that we are going to talk here about the or discuss about the far field pattern of the circular and square loops. So you can just consider the circular and square loops which is considered in the far field. Okay. And of the same area. Okay, that is very important, of the same area. Of the same area are the same when the loops of loops are small but different when they are large. Okay, so in terms of wavelength, so we are considering here the loop dimensions. When you are considering the loop dimensions, we are saying that it is small compared to that of wavelength, and we also say that we are doing all this process in the far field pattern. And thus we are, when we are considering the circular as well as the square loops, you can say that they are of the same area, which I have already mentioned before, which is of the same area, and when the and the same when the loops are small, but different when they are large. You can say that it will not be the same when the loops are large in terms of wavelength. Okay, so this is what you can just understand few things about it. So further on, uh, So to find the far field pattern in, you have to find the far field pattern in the YZ plane. So let us consider two linear dipoles 2 and 4 and the cross section through the loop in the YZ plane, which will be shown in the figure. So we need to find the far field pattern. So we are going to find the far field pattern in the YZ plane. So what we are going to do here is we are going to consider two linear, consider the linear dipole 2 and 4 and the cross section through the loops in the YZ plane. So I will show you the figure where it will be clear. So we are going to take a loop, a square loop, and we are going to place it at the center. So I can just show you the figure so it will be more clear for you. So this is what. So this is what you can see here. You have taken a loop, square loop, and you are just going to go with the 2 and 4. Okay, so that is placed in exactly at the center, and this figure we will be drawing it. So you can just complete this off, and then we will move on further. So once you complete it, just let me know that. So you can make a note of these points, and then we will proceed further by considering the linear dipoles 2 and 4, which is placed at the center, and the field pattern in the YZ plane can be considered there. Okay, the cross section through the loops in the YZ plane. So that will be shown in the figure. So we can just look into those things now. Is that over?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Let me just take you through the figure. So, here we have few derivations here, so that we'll be discussing. So, you can just draw this figure where you have the square loop, and the square loop is being placed at the center. And this is the direction of phi. The figure is the same. This is the direction of theta, and you have the components E phi and H theta. So as we have discussed, so the in far field, you know that the rest of the components will be zero. So as we have seen in the previous module as well. So we are taking a square loop, and we are going to do the derivations for that. Okay. So you can see the x, y, z directions, and theta and phi, direction of theta and phi, and you can see the square loop being placed at the center, and the field components generated are h theta and e phi, and the rest of the components in the far field, you know that it is zero. So you can make a note of this figure. So we are going to consider the dipole 2 and dipole 4, and we are going to simplify that. So these are the some of the things which you have to make sure that it is a small loop, and we have to make sure that we are assuming that this is in the far field, and when it is in the far field, the field components are E phi and H theta. Rest of the components become are zero in far field. You have studied in the previous classes. And then we are also considering the phi component and theta component, direction of theta and phi. All these things we have done. We also discussed upon the 1, 2, 3 and 4, which is placed in the square loop. And we are going to consider two dipoles, dipole 2 and dipole 4. So along with this figure, you can just have one more, that is you can say that two point sources we have considered, that is dipole 1 and dipole 2, and this is separated by a distance d, and this is the angle theta towards, and this is pointing towards the distinct point, okay. So I'll give you 1-2 minutes time. You can make a note of these things. So all these points you can plot it, and you have to make sure that you know that when you have taken the square loop, you know that one of the side is D. So also you have to make sure that when you take the dipole 1, dipole 2 and dipole 4, you have to see that we have separated by a distance of D and it is pointing towards a distant point. So you know the direction of theta and all those things. So this is, these two figures will help you to simplify the equations further. So have you completed it? Shall we move forward?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So you just recall the equations what we have studied in the previous modules. So that will be helpful for you. So like you have studied two isotropic point sources of same amplitude and all those things. So you just go back to those things and just keep a note of thing, those part that will be helpful for you to carry out with the equation. So here the field patterns of 2 and 4 dipole, so the field patterns of 2 and 4 dipole in the YZ plane can be represented as E phi can be represented as minus of E phi naught e to the power of j psi by 2 plus E phi naught e to the power of minus j psi by 2. So I'm going to simplify this further. So you can say that for the point sources or the field pattern for two and dipole 2 and 4, four dipoles in the YZ planes can be represented by using this equation. E phi is equal to, we have used this in previous modules as well. So same pattern, you can see that the E phi can be represented as minus E phi naught e to the power of j psi by 2 plus E phi naught e to the power of minus j psi by 2. So let us take some common terms outside and then simplify this further. So when you do that, E phi is the electric field from the individual dipole, and E phi naught is the electric field from the individual dipole, and we can write E phi is equal to, let me take the terms outside. So I am just taking minus 2 J E phi naught. So when I take it outside, I can say that the rest of our terms, left of our terms will be e to the power of j psi by 2 minus e to the power of minus j psi by 2 divided by 2j. This is what you are going to get it. So you will get E phi is equal to minus 2j E phi naught into e to the power of j psi by 2 minus e to the power of minus j psi by 2 divided by 2j. So you know, all of you know that e to the power of j psi by 2 minus e to the power of minus j psi by 2 divided by 2j can be replaced as sine or cos. So it can be replaced as sine of psi by 2. So we can just simplify that equation. E phi naught phi is equal to 2 minus 2j E phi naught sine psi by 2. All of you complete till here. So we have taken two dipoles, dipole 2 and dipole 4, and when we write the equation, we get E phi is equal to minus E phi naught e to the power of minus j psi by 2 plus E phi naught e to the power of minus j psi by 2. E phi naught is the electric field, and that is equal to minus 2 j E phi naught e to the power of j psi by 2 minus e to the power of minus j psi by 2 divided by 2j. And this can be written further as minus 2 j E phi naught sine of psi by 2. So some of the equations which we have discussed before, we have psi. The equation for psi can be written as 2 pi d by lambda sine theta, or you also write it as dr sine theta. So what was dr before? We have already studied dr is 2 pi d by lambda. So those things, it's a familiar equation for you. So psi is equal to 2 pi d by lambda sine theta, and 2 pi d by lambda can be specified as dr, and you can write it as dr sine theta. So let me substitute and simplify that further. So I have got the equation E phi is equal to minus 2j E phi naught sine psi by 2. So let me just substitute for sine. What is psi? Psi is dr cos theta, sorry, sine theta. So what is psi here? Psi is dr sine theta. So let me substitute that sine. When you substitute for psi, you get E phi is equal to minus 2j E phi naught sine dr by 2 sine theta. So you get E phi is equal to minus 2j E phi naught sine dr by 2 sine theta. So from this we can say that we have d is less than lambda. So at a small angle, sine x is approximately equal to x. So we can say that at very small angles, sine of x is approximately equal to x. Okay, those things you know that. So when d is less than lambda, we can see that how this can be further modified. So all of you will get it as E phi is equal to minus 2j. After substitution, you will get it as minus 2j E phi naught sine of dr by 2 sine theta. So you know that sine of an angle, if the theta is small or a small angle, you know that sine of an angle is always equal to x. So sine of x is approximately equal to x. So let me go further. So I am just replacing this equation further. So sine of this x is what? Dr by 2 sine theta. So sine of x is equal to x. So I can write it as, I can modify this equation further and I can write it as E phi is equal to minus j E phi naught dr by 2 sine theta. So I can write it as sine of an angle is if it is angle is small, you can say that it is the same. So I substituted that, so and simplified, cancelled out the terms. So I finally get E phi is equal to minus j E phi naught dr sine theta. So you get E phi is equal to minus j E phi naught dr sine theta. So now further we have to see the far field of individual dipole. So all of you can first complete these things and then we will proceed further. You can make a note of these equations and finally you will get the equation for E phi as minus j E phi naught dr sin theta. So let me take you through the far field of individual dipole. So these equations, I have told you that you have to remember these equations for far field of E theta, E phi and H theta. So let me use those equations here. So as we have studied before, the field of a individual dipole, the far field of an individual dipole, E phi can be represented as j 60 pi I sin theta by r into L by lambda. So this equation we have studied before in the fields of a short dipole, all those places we have seen the equations, and in the module 4 precise to say we have seen that E phi is equal to j 60 pi I sin theta divided by r multiplied by L by lambda. So that equation I am using it here since it is in the far field. So the angle theta, so I can say that the angle theta in the dipole is from the dipole axis and is 90 degrees. So I am considering that the angle theta in the dipole is from the dipole axis and we can take it as 90 degrees. So theta I have to substitute as 90 degrees. So sine 90 will come here. All of you know that what is sine 90. So let me use that thing. So when I substitute sine 90 here, instead of theta I am going to substitute 90. So I get it as sine 90. You get E phi is equal to E phi naught is equal to j 60 pi I sin 90 is 1, so that is you'll get L divided by r lambda. So all of you will get till here. For E phi naught we have simplified that, you got it as j 60 pi I L divided by r lambda. So here I current, we know that I is called as the redundant current on the dipole. We have already discussed this before. We have equation for I as well, which we have studied in the previous classes. So here I is the redundant current on the dipole, and R is, this R is called as the distance from the dipole. Okay, so substituting that E phi naught in the equation for E phi. So here what is E phi? E phi is minus J E phi naught dr sin theta. So let me just substitute E phi naught. So we got E phi naught as J 60 pi I L divided by R lambda. So let me go back and substitute here for E phi. So I have to substitute this equation here. So I have to substitute this equation here. So let me substitute E phi naught in this equation. So I get E phi. So I can get E phi. So when I substitute that, I get E phi is equal to 60 pi I. I is called as a redundant current I L dr sin theta divided by R lambda. This is what you get it. So we are discussing on the small loop, and we got the field E phi as 60 pi I L dr sin theta divided by R lambda. Here L is equal to D, length L is taken as D, which you have already seen in your figure, and dr, as you know that dr is 2 pi D by lambda, and so we can use these things further for simplification. So L is equal to D, and that's distance between the dipole, and then you can say that dr is 2 pi d by lambda as well, and we are going to simplify this further by using these equations for E phi. So once you note down this steps, and then we'll further continue. So dr, you got it as 2 pi d by lambda. All of you have completed till then. Have you all completed?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we got, we have L, where L is equal to D and dr is 2 pi D by lambda. The area A you can say that of the loop is D square. So area A for this loop is D square. So let me just substitute all those things and simplify that. So for small loop, I get E phi is equal to 60 pi I D 2 pi D by lambda sine theta divided by R lambda. I have just substituted. So I have substituted L is equal to D, and so I have substituted for all these things, L and dr, dr is 2 pi d by lambda. So when I do the substitution, I get it as 60 pi I d 2 pi d by lambda sin theta divided by R lambda. So when you can simplify this further, which are the common terms, you can cross it down and you can just write it there further. So when you simplify this further, E phi is equal to 120 pi square I sin theta by R into A by lambda square. What is area? Area is D square. So I might have I have substituted here, you will get D square. I have substituted as A. This is for E phi, And all of you know the relationship between the H theta and E phi. So it's a known equation and you have used it before as well. So the far field H theta can be found by using this equation. H theta is equal to E phi divided by 120 pi. And let me substitute E phi here and further simplify that. So when I do that, I get H theta is equal to pi I sine theta divided by r into a by lambda square. So that is what you get, the fields E theta and H phi, E phi and H theta. Rest of the components are zero for the far field, you know that. So we are getting the two components E phi and H theta, and these are the equations for E phi and H theta for the small loop. So let us have a comparison between the far field of small loop and short dipole. So that is what we are just going to compare, the far field of a small loop and short dipole. So you can make a note of these things, then we will do the comparison of fields due to small loop and short electric dipole. So that's what we got, the components E phi and H theta. So once you have completed that, we will move on to the next one. That is comparison of the field, far field of a small loop as well as short dipole. So here we are directly writing the equations for the electric dipole as well as the small loop. Small loop equations, we already got it. I have just written it there in a table. So you can see that I have written the fields, electric field as well as the magnetic field. In the case of electric dipole, it will be E naught is equal to, it will be J 60 pi I L sine theta divided by R lambda. And when you take small loop, it will be 120 pi, which we just received, which we just completed, 120 pi square I sine theta by r into a by lambda. And magnetic field will be, in this case, it will be h of phi is equal to j I l sine theta by 2 r lambda. And the field h of theta will be pi I sine theta divided by r into a by lambda square. So this is the comparison, you can say, between the far field of small loop as well as a short dipole. So you can make a note of all these equations now, and then we will continue with the next topic. I'll give you 2 minutes time, you can make a note of all these equations. So we have seen the comparison of the fields of a short dipole and a small loop. Then next we need to look into the loop antenna, a general case. So we will be studying that further. Yeah, all of you have completed. You can just put it in a table, the fields, electric and magnetic field, E theta and H phi, as well as E phi and H theta. So we should understand that all this are in the far field, okay? So you have already discussed all these things before. So we got the equations for the small loop. You know that why you specify it as a small loop. So conditions we have already seen. Now we are going to discuss upon the loop antenna, a general case. All of you have completed? Are you still noting down things or it is over? Bhumika, it's over?
Yes.
Okay. So I will just give you a brief description about this, and this diagram you can draw further. We are going to discuss upon the loop antenna, a general case. Just a brief description about this for today. That is, let us consider a loop antenna with uniform in phase current, and the size of the loop is may assume any value as compared to the wavelength. So this is what we are going to see, that here we are going to consider a loop antenna with uniform in phase current, and the size of the loop may be assumed that any value compared to the wavelength. And let the loop of radius be a. So the radius of that loop be A, and located within the center of the origin of the coordinate. So this is how the diagram will be. We are placing the loop at the center, and we are going to take a small part of it, and you are going to integrate it, okay? So to find the entire loop. So that is, we will be discussing this figure in the next class. So you can just make a note of these things, that is loop antenna. This topic we will be further discussing in the next class in detail. We have a small derivation to do it, and we'll be completing those things. So you can just write the topic loop antenna, a general case. So here we are going to assume that we are considering that a loop antenna with uniform in phase current, and the size of the loop may be assumed any value as compared to the wavelength. So the loop have with a radius of A and located at the center at the origin of the coordinates, which we can see in the figure. Okay, so this is what you are going to see, and we are going to do that. So all of you can just make a note of these things, and we'll continue this topic in the next class. So you can make a note of these things. That's all for today. We will wind up with this, and we'll continue with this topic in the upcoming class, loop antenna, a general case. Okay. Thank you all.